So now we're going to start looking at the bread and butter of pharmacology, the general pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamic principles. A drug is any substance that is used in the diagnosis, cure, treatment, or prevention of a disease or condition. This is a general definition that is not very useful because of the great diversity of characteristics and actions of drugs. To be more precise, pharmacokinetics is the study of the action of drugs in the body, including the process of absorption, distribution, metabolism, and elimination. It may be thought of as what the body does to the drug. Pharmacodynamics, on the other hand, is the study of the biochemical and physiologic effects of drugs on the function of a living organism and of their component parts. It includes consideration of the mechanisms of drug action and may be viewed as what the drug does to the body. So important prerequisite for understanding pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics requires the understanding of scientific principles of biochemistry, anatomy and physiology, pathophysiology, necessary for the provider to progress from memorization of drug names to understanding of the process of drug use and being able to generalize from basic principles. Pharmacokinetics focuses on the process concerned with absorption, distribution, biotransformation or metabolism, and excretion or elimination of the drug. Pharmacodynamics is the study of the biochemical and physiologic effects of the drugs and the mechanisms of their action. A concise definition of pharmacodynamics is to be remembered as the effect of the drug on the body. So this is a nice chart that kind of breaks down the process of pharmacokinetics. You look at absorption, and the sites of absorption is the gut to the plasma. The concepts you must think about is bioavailability. And factors to consider include drug characteristics, blood flow, and cell membranes. For distribution, the sites include plasma to the tissue. Concepts to master include volume of distribution. And phases include blood flow from the site of administration to the delivery of drug into the tissues at site of drug action. For biotransformation, the site involves the liver, and concepts that you need to understand include enzyme inhibition, induction, and first pass effect. And this includes phase one of the oxidation, the cytochrome P450 enzyme system, and phase two, glucosylation phase. For elimination, the site elimination includes the kidneys, and concepts to master include clearance, half-life, steady state, linear and nonlinear kinetics. So let's look at drug nomenclature. Drugs have three names: a chemical name, a generic name, and a trade or brand name. The chemical name describes the drug's chemical composition and molecular structure. The generic name is the official name assigned by the manufacturer with the approval of the U.S. Adopted Name Council and is the name listed in pharmacology reference books. The trade name is the patent name given to the medicine by the company that is marketing the drug. If more than one company manufactures the drug, then the drug will have more than one trade name. Trade names are usually simpler and easier to remember than the generic names because drug companies want you to remember their name and use their drug. The generic name often will identify the type of drug that it is and will reveal the therapeutic effect. For example, it's important to identify a beta blocker by the similar sounding generic names such as atenolol, metoprolol, and propranolol, versus learning the trade names such as tenormin, lopressor, and inderol. Providers should refer to drugs by their generic names when communicating with patients and other healthcare providers. This is very important with over-the-counter medications because the contents of trade names products may vary. So let's take a look at absorption. Absorption describes how the drug leaves its site of administration. The bioavailability of the product is what is most important clinically. Bioavailability is how much of the drug that is administered reaches its site of action. The fraction of the drug that reaches the systemic circulation is called the F value. After a solid or liquid drug has been orally ingested, the drug must break up or disintegrate and then become soluble in body fluids, also called dissolution, before the process of pharmacokinetic absorption begins. Bioequivalence is an issue with generic versus trade drugs. Bioequivalence means that two drug products contain the same active ingredients, are identical in strength or concentration, dosage form, and route of administration, and have essentially the same rate and extent of bioavailability. Although a generic drug may have the same amount of drug, because of the variability in the way the medication is manufactured, slightly more or less drug may be bioavailable. Legally, the drug must be plus or minus 20% of the proprietary drug. This variance becomes a concern with certain drugs, especially when the therapeutic window is narrow, such as with drugs such as Lanoxin versus Digoxin. Avoiding variation and complying with the preferred drug formularies are the major reasons for ordering dispense as written trade name prescriptions. There are four primary factors that must be considered in evaluating drug absorption. These include drug characteristics, routes of administration, blood flow, and cell membrane. Let's first look at drug characteristics. Some general drug characteristics relevant to all routes of administration. These include the formulation of the drug. This influences the dissolution rate of solid form of the solid form of drug, the concentration of the drug. The higher the concentration, the more quickly the drug is absorbed. Lipophilic drug formulations are more readily absorbable. Non-ionized drugs are more lipid soluble and may readily diffuse across cell membranes. These would make absorption quicker. Ionized drugs are lipid insoluble and thus non-diffusible, which will make it longer. Acidic drugs become non-ionized in the acidity of the stomach and then diffuse across membranes. Basic drugs such as alkaloids tend to ionize and are not well absorbed in the stomach, but they may be better absorbed in the small intestines where the acid levels are less. A change in the pH of the stomach will affect the absorption of many drugs. The other issues you must look at is routes of administration, oral versus sublingual versus topical versus rectal versus inhalation versus ophthalmic routes. Generally, sublingual are absorbed faster than oral. Blood flow will also affect absorption. If patient has less blood flow to an area, then it's going to be absorbed less quickly. And cell membrane characteristics are important in absorption. When you look at biotransformation or metabolism, biotransformation is the chemical inactivation of a drug through conversion to a more water-soluble compound that can be excreted from the body. Biotransformation occurs primarily in the liver, but it may also be found in the lungs and in the GI tract. It involves two major steps in enzyme activity. Phase 1 makes a drug more hydrophilic through oxidation, reduction, and hydrolysis. Minor changes in the structure of the drug make it more hydrophilic, but allow it to maintain all or part of its pharmacological activity. The cytochrome P450 enzyme system is part of phase 1. Phase 2 is called glucuronidation. It involves conjugation or attachment of particles to the molecule, making it highly water-soluble, a water-soluble substance with little or no pharmacological activity. If blood flow to the liver is decreased, drugs will be metabolized more slowly, leading to a longer duration of action. Lipophilic drugs easily pass through membranes, including renal tubules, making it difficult to excrete. Biotransformation changes a lipophilic drug that is active and transports it into a hydrophilic inactive compound that is readily excreted. However, metabolites occasionally have biological activity or toxic properties. So again, biotransformation is the metabolism of the drug. It's the chemical inactivation of a drug. Conversion to a more water-soluble compound that can be excreted from the body, and this primarily occurs in the liver. You can also see this happening in the lungs as well as the GI tract, and occurs in two steps. Phase 1, in which the drug becomes more hydrophilic through oxidation, reduction, and hydrolysis, and change phase 2, in which it involves conjugation or attachment of particles to the molecule, making it highly water-soluble with little or no pharmacological activity. Then we move on to distribution. Distribution is the transport of a drug in body fluids from the bloodstream at the site of absorption to various tissues in the body. The pattern of distribution depends on the pharmacokinetic activity of different types of tissues and the different physicochemical properties of the drugs. Drugs vary in their ability to move into various body compartments such as the brain, fat, lungs, eyes. The best way to know how much of a given drug gets into a particular body compartment is to consult standard reference texts. No one can really remember all of the different concentrations of drugs that get into body systems. However, there are many different charts and references in which you can look these up. Because blood is an easily accessible body fluid, blood concentrations often are studied to determine how they relate to drug concentrations in other body compartments. The dose-related effects of a drug are then correlated with a given blood concentration or range of concentration. Once a relationship has been established, blood concentrations can be used to monitor therapy. Distribution consists of two phases. The first involves movement from the site of administration into the bloodstream. Delivery of the drug into the tissue at the site of action is the second phase of distribution. the volume of distribution is a concept that is useful in understanding where the drug goes once it's absorbed. Volume of distribution is a description of the amount of space in which a drug can be spread or distributed. It is the calculated volume or size of a compartment necessary to account for the total amount of drug in the body if it were present throughout the body at the same concentration found in the plasma. Because most drugs are not equally distributed, this is a theoretical concept and not a real volume. It is, however, useful in predicting drug concentrations, understanding how well a drug is absorbed into the tissues, and understanding whether it will be accumulated in the tissues. If a drug has a small volume of distribution, it stays in the central compartment and is not widely distributed. If the drug has a large volume of distribution, it is found widely throughout the body. The larger the volume of distribution, the more drug there is in the tissue. Because we are able to measure the amount of drug in the bloodstream only through serum levels, calculation of volume of distribution allows us to estimate or predict the concentration of drug in the tissue. The volume of distribution may be calculated, which means that the volume of distribution is equal to the dose of drug in the body divided by the concentration in the blood. Water-soluble drugs have a volume of distribution that is similar to the plasma volume because they are distributed into the blood. The plasma volume for a normal adult is about 3 to 5 liters. Lipophilic drugs have a larger volume of distribution. The total volume, fluid volume in the body is about 40 liters for a 70 kilo or 150 pound person. Because the volume of distribution of a lipophilic drug can exceed this volume, it is important to remember that this calculation is of a hypothetical volume, not a real volume. It is the volume that would be required to contain the entire drug in the body if the drug were distributed in the same concentration as the blood or plasma. Factors that affect the volume of distribution include plasma protein binding, obesity, edema, and tissue binding. Therefore, the volume of distribution for a given drug can change as a function of the patient's age, gender, disease, and body composition. Geriatric patients often have relatively less muscle and more fat, placing them at risk for accumulation of lipophilic drugs in the adipose tissue. If these patients lose weight and take the same dose, they could become toxic. This can be a particular problem with lipophilic benzodiazepines. In these patients, water-soluble drugs have a smaller volume of distribution, resulting in increased blood concentrations. This effect is even greater if the patient is dehydrated. An example of a drug that may cause this problem is gentamicin. In addition, excess fluid in the interstitial spaces, such as seen with in patients with edema, will affect the distribution of water-soluble drugs. Any alteration in normal muscle-to-fat ratio will change the volume of distribution of a drug. In obesity, lipophilic drugs are distributed into adipose tissue and tend to accumulate. This little drug is available elsewhere to produce an effect. For an example of this is phenobarbital. Phenobarbital is fat-soluble. The drug may become trapped in the fatty tissue, causing low blood levels of phenobarbital. Fat-soluble drugs are slowly released from the fat into the bloodstream, so they have a longer duration of action. This factor may also prolong the duration of side effects or may affect dosing schedules. Drugs that are highly protein-bound, more than 90%, have a volume of distribution that is about the same as the amount of plasma. This is a small volume of distribution. An example would be the thyroid hormones. If the patient has a decreased serum albumin, more active drug is available for protein-bound drugs. If two protein-bound drugs are used, the most tightly protein-bound drug will tend to displace the other. Example of these drugs include furosemide and the cephalosporins. Another common change that may affect the distribution of drugs in older adults is a decrease in serum albumin. Albumin concentrations decrease slightly with age in most elderly patients, although significant changes that may affect drug therapy may be seen in the chronically ill or malnourished elderly patient. Albumin is the most common protein that binds to various acidic drugs. Significant decreases in albumin may result in greater free concentration of highly protein-bound drugs. In the Edmonds text box, chat box 4.3 lists some of the drugs that have significant protein binding, which may result in greater free concentration when albumin is significantly reduced. Generally, drugs that are highly protein-bound to albumin should be prescribed in reduced dosages for patients with low serum albumin values. A practical example of the clinical significance of this relationship can be described with the anticonvulsant phenytoin. In an elderly patient with low serum albumin concentration, the phenytoin level reported from virtually all laboratories is the bound concentration. In a hypoalbuminemic individual, this value may appear normal or even subtherapeutic. This is because of the greater amounts of free or non-bound phenytoin that are getting into the tissues and acting at the receptor level but are not portrayed in the total serum level. The actual level may be much higher even in the toxic range. Treatment decisions with older adults should not be based solely on drug levels. Treatment decisions must be based on consideration of both patient characteristics as well as drug levels. Other protein changes may also have an influence on drug therapy. Patients with acute disease, such as a myocardial infarction, respiratory distress, or infectious insults, for example, may experience increase in alpha-1 glycoprotein, which is an acute phase reactant protein. This may result in increased binding of weakly basic drugs, including propranolol or lidocaine, and a less than normal response to therapy. Some drugs have an affinity for specific tissues. This affinity becomes useful when patients with certain infections are under treatment. For example, ciprofloxacin and tetracycline have an affinity for bone, so these are useful in patients with bony infections. It is not generally necessary to calculate the volume of distribution when drugs are used. However, it's an important concept to understand when one is administering a drug, and it may influence the dosage or choice of a drug. Always consider where the drug will go and how much will get to the target organ or tissue. The distribution of drugs from the bloodstream to the central nervous system is different than through other cell membranes. The endothelial cells of the brain capillaries do not have intracellular pores and vesicles. Passive diffusion of hydrophilic drugs is restricted. However, lipophilic drugs will easily pass the blood-brain barrier, limited only by cerebral blood flow. Highly fat-soluble drugs also cross the blood-brain barrier easily and are likely to cause central nervous system side effects such as confusion and drowsiness. So now we'll move on to biotransformation or metabolism of the drug. This occurs in two phases. Phase 1, oxidation or reduction. The cytochrome P450 enzyme system operates throughout the body and is concentrated in the liver, intestine, and lungs. The P450 enzyme system resides in the ribosomes. The family of enzymes is divided into groups according to similarity. The groups most important to human drug interactions are the CYPD CYP2D6, the CYP3A3/4, CYP1A2, the CYP2C9/10, and CYP2C19. I do not expect you to know these, but just be familiar with the nomenclature. Phase 2 involves conjugation, where the drugs become highly water-soluble with little or no pharmacological activity. So phase 1, oxidation or reduction of the drugs, which makes the drugs more hydrophilic. This occurs through the cytochrome P450 enzyme system. And phase 2, biotransformation, which involves conjugation, where the drugs become highly water-soluble substances with little or no pharmacological activity so that they can be excreted. So let's look a little bit more at phase 1. Phase 1 involves the oxidation or reduction in which hydrolysis reactions that make drugs more water soluble occur so that they can be excreted. During this phase, as many as 40 different P450 enzymes present in the liver may be available to participate as catalysts in the oxidation of drugs. It appears that the metabolism of most drugs can be accounted for by a relatively small subset of these enzymes, with probably half attributed to the CYP3A4. The cytochrome P450 enzyme system operates throughout the body. It's concentrated in the liver, intestine, and lungs, and resides in the ribosomes, which are sacs in the endoplasmic reticulum. It is named P450 because this is the length of the wave of light that these enzymes absorb. Chemically, the enzyme is a glycoprotein or a sugar plus a protein. Many of the proteins contain heme, hence the name chrome. The family of enzymes is divided into groups according to the similarities. At least 40 major groups have been identified in humans. The major group named 1, 2, 3, and 4 are known to be involved in drug interactions. These major groups are further divided into groups by the chemical structure named A, B, and C. The A, B, and C groups are then divided into subgroups 1, 2, 3, and so on. The groups that are most important in human drug interactions are the CYP2D6, the CYP3A3/4, and the CYP1A2, CYP2C910, and the CYP2C19. In the groups with 3/4 and 9/10, the two are so close in structure that they are difficult to differentiate and have very similar actions. So again, the enzymes are divided into four groups. The major groups are 1, 2, 3, 4. These major groups are further divided into groups by the chemical structures A, B, C, D, C, and A, B, C groups are divided into subgroups 1, 2, 3, and so on. The P450 enzyme system is not the same in every individual. Each person receives genetic material that determines individual variations in the enzyme system. This is called genetic polymorphism. Thus, individual differences in racial and gender differences occur. These are not yet well known or understood, but patients express their enzyme system in different ways. This explains why different patients react differently to a drug. For example, some patients metabolize codeine through the CYP2D6 quickly and need larger doses, whereas other patients metabolize it slowly and need less. The essential fact to master about the P450 enzyme systems are that 6 primary enzymes account for the metabolism of nearly all clinically important drugs, and 2 of these systems are critically important for drug metabolism. You can see this in table 3/1 in Edmund's text. The CYP3A4 is an enzyme needed for the metabolism of many drugs such as antihistamines, antibiotics, lipid-lowering drugs, antihypertensive, protease inhibitors, and azole antifungals. This system is used in the metabolism of approximately 50% of all clinically useful medications. These enzymes are the most abundant and clinically significant. In the CYP3A4, the notation CYP indicates that the property is part of the cytochrome P450 system. 3 indicates the family. A indicates the subfamily, and 4 indicates that it is the fourth enzyme in that subsystem. The CYP2D6 enzyme looks different and is different. It metabolizes selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, or the SSRIs, pain relievers, beta blockers, and other drugs. This enzyme metabolizes about 30% of all clinically useful medications. It's the second most abundant and participates in converting codeine to morphine. Of the other 4 enzymes, the most notable features include the CYP2C19, which metabolizes protein pump inhibitors, NSAIDs, and beta blockers, the CYP2C9, which metabolizes sulfonylureas, NSAIDs, warfarin, and sildenafil citrate, or Viagra, the CYP1A2, which metabolizes acetaminophen, also morphine, theophylline, caffeine, diazepam, and verapamil, and the CYP2E1, which metabolizes acetaminophen, ethanol, inactivation of toxins, and dextromorphan. A drug can be a substrate or one that is affected by alterations of its enzyme metabolism. A drug can also be the one that causes the alteration in enzyme metabolism of another drug by being an inhibitor or an inducer. The cytochrome P450 enzyme system may speed up a reaction because it causes the drug to change to a more hydrophilic substance. Any drug that causes the enzyme to metabolize more slowly or decrease the capacity of the enzyme pathway is called an inhibitor. For an example, if a patient on Prozac or fluoxetine takes Coumadin or warfarin, the fluoxetine inhibits the P450 enzyme system from metabolizing warfarin and may produce an exaggerated therapeutic response, thus bleeding. A drug that causes the enzyme to metabolize the substrate more quickly is called an inducer. These types of drugs increase enzyme activity by increasing the number of CYP450 enzymes. A drug can be involved in this process in 2 ways. It can be the drug or substrate that is being acted on, or it can be the inhibitor or inducer that is acting on the enzyme to increase or decrease enzyme conversion of the substrate drug into an inactive compound. The same drug can be both a substrate and an inducer or inhibitor. For example, carbamazepine is an autoinducer. It induces its own metabolism. It is the enzyme system and not the drug that is being induced or inhibited. A drug can inhibit an enzyme pathway through 2 mechanisms. The first is competition, which is usually not a problem. If it occurs, it occurs immediately. Most inhibition is metabolic. Then the inhibitor drug decreases the production of the enzyme. It shrinks the enzyme pathway. This is not an immediate reaction. It may take anywhere from 24 hours up to a week to see the effect, depending on the half-life of the drug. From a pharmacokinetic standpoint, the major effects of drug-to-drug interactions are understood in terms of causing a high or low plasma and tissue level of the drug. enzyme induction is much, much less common than inhibition. These drugs make the pathway work quickly, causing the substrate drug to be deactivated more rapidly. This will lower the level of the drug in the body. The clinically important inducers include the anticonvulsants. All anticonvulsants should be considered as possible inducers. Evaluation of these drugs is particularly important when they're being added to a patient's medication regimen. In addition to the cytochrome P450, oxidation of drugs and other xenobiotics can be mediated by non-P450 enzymes, the most significant which are flavin monooxygenase, monoamine oxidase, alcohol dehydrogenase, aldehyde dehydrogenase, aldehyde oxidase, and xanthine oxidase. Drug oxidation catalyzed by some of these enzymes may produce the same metabolites as those generated by the P450. Thus, drug interactions may be difficult to predict without a clear knowledge of the underlying enzyme. Although oxidation catalyzed by non-P450 enzymes can lead to drug inactivation, oxidation may be essential for the generation of active metabolites that create drug action. So again, oxidation or reduction of drugs, the drugs play various roles in metabolism. The substrate is when a drug that is affected by a change in its enzyme metabolism. An inducer is a drug that causes acceleration of the enzyme metabolism of another drug, or an inhibitor is a drug that causes inhibition in the enzyme metabolism of another drug. Moving on to phase two of biotransformation of metabolism. Another very important concept to master is the first pass effect. The first pass is a pass from the intestine directly to the liver by way of the hepatic portal blood flow. To compensate for this, very large amounts of the drug must be given so a sufficient dose will remain after the first pass through the liver prodrug occurs. Examples of this include angiotensin-converting enzymes. These drugs go through first pass effect in which they pass directly from the intestine to the liver by way of hepatic blood flow. You need very large amounts of these drugs, so the dose will remain high after the first pass effect through the liver. Phase two, or biotransformation, consists of conjugate reactions in which a compound is added to the drug. These reactions bind a chemical group to the drug compound via a covalent linkage. The chemical groups added to the drug are generally highly polar or ionized. This makes them water soluble and generally inactive. However, a few of these conjugate compounds are active. Again, the first pass effect, when a medication is taken orally, it passes from the intestine directly to the liver by way of the hepatic portal blood flow. This occurs via the portal vein. Many drugs, such as nitroglycerin and estrogens, are extensively metabolized to inert compounds when they first pass through the liver. Because of this, very large amounts of the drugs must be given for a sufficient dose to remain after the first pass through the liver. This is known as the first pass effect. It is why these drugs are often given via an alternative route, such as sublingual or topical, to avoid the liver on the first pass. Alternative route dosing also makes it possible to give smaller amounts of the drug and have it be effective. Prodrug is a chemical that is pharmacologically inactive. It is biotransformed into a biologically active metabolite in the body. The angiotensin-converting enzyme inhibitor, enalapril, is an example of a medication that must be transformed from a prodrug to the biologically active metabolite. This activity may be reduced in congestive heart failure if the liver is congested, and it will result in delaying treatment of the patient with heart failure. So again, to review, phase two involves the first pass effect, in which the drug first passes through the liver and is extensively metabolized into inert compounds and become inactive. This is why sometimes you need to look at alternative routes to avoid this first pass effect. And the prodrug, which is an inactive drug that is transformed into an active metabolite in the body. Looking at elimination, creatinine clearance can be estimated using calculations. Many labs now calculate the clearance routinely with metabolic profiles, and many medical calculators have this built into the programs. Elimination is the process by which drugs and metabolites are removed from the body. The liver and kidney are the two major organs responsible for elimination. This is why creatinine clearance is so important. Most elimination occurs through excretion by the kidneys. The process involved in renal elimination consists of glomerular filtration, tubular secretion, and partial reabsorption. In glomerular filtration, the drug enters the renal tubule by filtration. However, when this occurs depends on the amount of protein binding, because a drug does not filter into the tubule if it is bound to a protein. This action also depends on the rate of glomerular filtration, which in turn depends on kidney function and cardiovascular status of the patient. Active carrier-mediated tubular secretion is responsible for adding some organic anion and cation molecules to the proximal renal tubule. The carrier systems are fairly non-selective, and organic ions compete for transport. Thus, two drugs may compete for the same active transport carriers, and their excretion will be slowed. Although it may be difficult to predict the result, a drug can be both secreted and actively reabsorbed. Penicillins is an important example of this process. Once the drug has been excreted via active transport in the proximal tubule, weakly acidic or alkaline molecules may undergo passive reabsorption. How much is reabsorbed depends on the pH of the urine. Alkalization of the urine will increase the excretion of acidic molecules. Acidification of the urine will increase the excretion of basic molecules. Clinical alteration of the pH of urine will hasten the excretion of some drugs, as in the case of drug poisoning or drug toxicity. So again, elimination is when drugs and their metabolites are removed from the body. The primary sites are the liver and the kidney, and renal insufficiency or damage, you must look at creatinine clearance before modifying the dosage of a medication. You need to know how much will be cleared through the kidneys. There are other routes of elimination. Drugs and their metabolites may be excreted through fecal and respiratory routes, through breast milk, and in other ways. The fecal route is often clinically significant. Drugs are metabolized in the liver, and the metabolites are excreted in the bile. These metabolites are reabsorbed into the blood and then excreted in the urine, or less commonly, are simply excreted in the feces. Excretion from the liver into the bile is accomplished by active transport systems, which are limited in the quantity of metabolites they can excrete. Different drugs may compete for transport. this competition may slow down the excretion of certain drugs. Steroids provide an example of medication that causes competition and it slows excretion. The respiratory route is also an important route of excretion in anesthetic gases. Excretion in breast milk is important not for the quantity excreted, but because of the effect it may have on the nursing infant. Other routes such as perspiration, saliva, tears, hair, and skin are usually not clinically significant. However, you must keep these in mind. So again, let's clearance, talk about creatinine clearance in elimination. The calculation of clearance includes the rate of removal of a drug in milligrams per minute divided by the plasma concentration of a drug in milligrams per milliliter. If the glomerular filtration rate in the kidneys is reduced, the drug remains in the blood longer. In patients with kidney damage, it's necessary to calculate an estimated creatinine clearance to modify the dosage of medication. If the patient has a decrease in the creatinine clearance, then less drug should be prescribed. Clearance is loosely defined as a measure of the rate at which the drug is removed by the body, from the body. The body can eliminate the drug only if the drug is in contact with the elimination or eliminating organ. If the drug is being stored in adipose tissue, it cannot be cleared from the body. Thus, volume of distribution affects the clearance of a drug and hence the half-life. Specifically, clearance is defined as the volume of plasma from which all drug is removed in a given time. It is measured as volume divided by time. The formula yields milliliters of plasma that has had the drug removed from it in the specified amount of time, usually 1 minute. A total body clearance is the sum of clearances from the various metabolizing and eliminating organs. Steady state means there is a stable concentration of the drug or the drug is being administered at the same rate at which it is being eliminated. This is fairly simple with a continuous infusion of drugs. With intermittent administration of medication, the frequency and the amount of the drug must be adjusted to achieve a steady state. For example, Parkinson's medications such as Sinemet or carbidopa levodopa often require adjustment for both the amount and the interval of dosing to achieve therapeutic levels without reaching toxic levels. Patients who are eliminating a drug more slowly than normal will need smaller doses than will patients who are eliminating the drug normally. So again, elimination involves clearance, the volume of plasma from which all drug is removed within a given time. If a drug is stored in adipose tissue, it cannot be cleared from the body. It is lipophilic, and the volume of distribution affects the clearance of a drug and the half-life. So let's look again at elimination. Here is a nice schematic view. The plasma concentration time curve. This illustrates what happens when a single dose of a drug is given. The time between when the drug is given and when it first takes effect is called the latent period. Onset of action is the time it takes first takes effect. When the drug no longer has an effect, this is known as termination of action. The duration of action is the period of time from which the drug has its effect. The minimal effective concentration is the lowest level of concentration that produces the drug effect. The peak plasma level is the highest level the drug reaches. If the concentration is high enough to cause adverse drug reaction, this level is known as the toxic level. The therapeutic range is the area between the minimal effective concentration and the toxic concentration. So looking at this time curve, you see the onset of action. The duration of action is from the onset of action to the termination of action. The therapeutic range is the minimum effective concentration to the peak plasma level. As we move from onset of action, we move from absorption to elimination, in which we have the termination of effect. In intermittent administration of medication, the frequency and the amount of drug must be adjusted for steady state to be achieved. Again, an example of this is the carbidopa, levodopa, or Senemet. Patients who are eliminating drugs more slowly than others will need smaller doses of the drug. The drug concentration is increased or decreased in a linear fashion, depending on the dosage, clearance, volume of distribution, and half-life. It depends on the clearance and the volume of distribution. These all play a role in some way in maintaining concentration that is effective for the patient. So again, elimination involves linear or first order kinetics. Drug levels increase or decrease in a linear fashion depending on the concentration in the plasma. Well, this makes sense. A steady state occurs when a drug has stable concentration or when a drug is administered at the same rate at which it is eliminated. Well, this makes sense as well. Half-life is the length of time required for the amount of drug in the body to decrease by one half. Half-life is a very important concept, so you can determine how often to give medication or how long it will take for the medication to be eliminated from the body. So looking at first order linear kinetics, again, drugs with long half-lives must be closely monitored because of toxic effects or adverse reactions may last a long time. The concept of half-life is an important one to understand. The half-life of a drug is the amount of time required for the amount of drug in the body to decrease by one half. Thus, one half of the drug is eliminated. This is a significant factor in accumulation and elimination of drugs. It depends on clearance and volume of distribution. When a patient is given a drug on a regular schedule, the drug will continue to accumulate until a steady state is achieved. The half-life of a drug is listed in many different reference books and is an approximation of what most likely or usual half-life will be in a normal, healthy adult. However, much individual variation occurs and is based on factors that affect volume of distribution and elimination. Half-life is useful in estimating the amount of time it takes to reach a steady state of a drug after dosage regimen is started. Steady state is reached after 4 to 5 half-lives, which represent 94% to 97% of the eventual steady state. Half-life also can be used to estimate the amount of time it takes to eliminate a drug from the body after it has been discontinued. Again, after 4 to 5 half-lives, about 94 to 97% of the drug will have been eliminated from the body. Of course, there's always a difference between the absolute or theoretical steady state and what is seen, in fact, in each patient. So to review, when a patient is given a drug on a regular schedule, the drug will continue to accumulate until a steady state is achieved. The steady state is reached after 4 to 5 half-lives. After 4 to 5 half-lives, 94% to 97% of the drug is eliminated. This is a graphical representation of time in half-lives. As you see, drugs are introduced to the body after, for example, one half-life, 50% of this drug is eliminated. Two half-lives, 75%. Three half-lives, 88%. Four half-lives, 94%. And five half-lives, 97%. This is why we say between four to five half-lives, 94% to 97% of the drug is eliminated. Drugs with short half-lives include ibuprofen and the benzodiazepine, lorazepam. Examples with long half-lives are anticoagulants, diazepam, digoxin, and Prozac. Drugs with long half-lives must be closely monitored because toxic effects or adverse reactions may last a long time. It takes longer to eliminate these drugs from the body. In a linear or first-order kinetics, drug concentrations is increased or decreased in a linear fashion, depending on dosage clearance, volume of distribution, and half-life. The drug appears and disappears from plasma, depending on concentration. However, the percent of drug eliminated is constant. So the average concentration when the steady state is attained during intermittent drug administration can be calculated by the drug availability times the dose divided by clearance times time. This will give you the concentration, average concentration. Again, nonlinear zero order kinetics, when the amount of drug concentration exceeds the ability of the liver to metabolize the drug, the nonlinear kinetics or zero order kinetics is more complicated. In this case, elimination does not depend on the dose or concentration of the drug. The amount of drug eliminated is constant. The drug is removed by saturation of a function such as protein binding, limiting the amount of protein available for binding, hepatic metabolism, limiting the amount of enzyme causing metabolism, or active renal transport, limiting the amount of carrier. The half-life of the drug depends on the concentration. Phenytoin and theophylline are good examples. Phenytoin is a clinically important example of nonlinear kinetics because both protein binding and hepatic metabolism. As phenytoin is absorbed, it is bound to plasma protein. When a regimen is started, most of the drug is bound to protein, leaving little free drug. However, as the proteins reach saturation, suddenly a much greater percentage of the absorbed drug is not protein bound and is a free drug. When the proteins are saturated, suddenly the free drug, measured as a serum drug level, rises rapidly. A narrow therapeutic window makes toxicity a frequent problem. When the amount of drug concentration exceeds the ability of the liver to metabolize the drug, nonlinear kinetics occur. Again, the body has a finite ability to produce enzymes that metabolize the drug. Once the body is working at capacity, any additional drug will accumulate and cause toxicity. Another example of a drug that follows nonlinear kinetic principle is theophylline. Drugs that follow nonlinear kinetics are far more difficult to maintain in the therapeutic range and must be monitored closely for toxicity. Half-life depends on the concentration of the drug, and the drug is removed after via saturation of a function such as protein binding, hepatic metabolism, and active renal transport. Again, keep in mind that toxicity is a frequent problem. with these nonlinear zero order kinetics. Pharmacodynamics, or the effect of the drug on the body. Ligands are drugs, neurotransmitters, and hormones. These concepts sound simple and obvious, but they are important to understand how drugs elicit their effect. The mechanism of action is an important concept as well. Most drugs act on the body via chemical reactions with some large molecular component of the organism. The drug alters the function of the component, thereby causing biochemical and physiological changes that are characteristic of the response to the particular drug. The drug interacts with a chemical receptor. The concept of drug receptors explains the mechanism of action of drugs. Drug receptors are important in the mechanism of action because a receptor is the component of the organism that binds to a ligand and produces a change in function in the body. Drugs, neurotransmitters, and hormones are known as ligands. In general, drugs produce their effects by interacting with a receptor. This concept sounds obvious, but it's important to understand how drugs accomplish what they do. An example is a hormone molecule. Drugs generally do not create an effect by themselves, but through a receptor. The site at which a drug acts depends on localization of the specific receptor. The concept also sounds very obvious, but again, it's important to understand how drugs accomplish what they do. Most drug receptors are proteins. Some of the most clinically important receptors are cellular proteins whose normal functions are to be receptors for bodily regulatory molecules or endogenous molecules. Examples of such molecules are hormones and neurotransmitters. Receptors can be enzymes that are chemical in nature, making it easy for reactions to occur, but they are not totally used up by the reactions. Enzymes free themselves and then continue to be available for reactions with other substrates. The lock and key model of drug receptor interaction states the drug molecule must fit into a receptor much like the way a key fits into a lock. Drug affinity is the propensity of a drug to bind or attach itself to a given receptor. Two types of drug receptor interactions occur: agonists and antagonists. An agonist is a drug that has an affinity for the stimulant and stimulates physiological activity at cell receptors normally activated by naturally occurring substances. An antagonist is a drug that inhibits or counteracts effects produced by other drugs or eliminates undesired physiological effects caused by illness. An antagonist may work competitively with an affinity for the same receptor sites as an agonist, or may be non-competitive, in which case it inactivates the receptor so that the agonist cannot be effective at any concentration. So again, to review, drug receptor, our receptor is the component of the organism that binds to a ligand, which is drug, hormone, or neurotransmitter, and produces a change in function within the body. Drugs can cause effect by interacting with receptors, and the site where the drug acts depends on the location of the receptor. Some drugs interact with small molecules or ions that are found in the body. For example, antacids neutralize gastric acid in the stomach. other drugs have structures close enough to normal biological chemicals that the body may incorporate them into cellular components. Thus, function may be altered. Example of this type of activity includes purines that are incorporated into nucleic acids and are useful in treating cancers and viruses. Recombinant DNA may also serve in this manner while working with new drugs or being used in new treatment regimens. Attempts to quantify the drug-receptor interactions involves calculating the concentration of dose-response relationships. Agonist drug interactions with a receptor are reversible. The amount of effect depends on how many receptors are occupied or being acted on by the drug. Efficacy is a drug's ability to produce a therapeutic or intended effect. Free drug is the amount of drug in the body that is able to bind the receptor, i.e. the drug not bound to plasma proteins. Potency is the dependency of effect on its concentration. A drug is more potent than another if less drug is needed to achieve the desired effect. An agonist will bind to a receptor or to inhibit the action of a drug, but has no intrinsic action of its own. Inhibition is competitive if it can be overcome by the increased concentration of the agonist. A non-competitive agonist prevents the action of the agonist at any concentration. So again, some drugs are not mediated by receptors, but interaction with small molecules or ions that are found in the body or have structures close enough to normal biological chemicals that the body may incorporate them into cellular components. Adverse drug reactions or events are defined by the World Health Organization as a response to a drug that is noxious and unintended and occurs at doses normally used for man for prophylaxis, diagnosis, or therapy of disease, or for the modification of physiological function. Essentially, an adverse drug event is any undesirable experience associated with the use of a drug or medical product in a patient. Adverse reactions include any response to a drug that is unfavorable or unintended and that occurs at doses used in humans for prophylaxis, diagnosis, or therapy of disease, or for modification of physiological function. This is different from a side effect, which is an additional effect, desirable or undesirable, of a drug that is not the primary purpose of giving the drug. For example, an adverse reaction could be the development of pancytopenia from taking chlorpheniramine. A side effect may include photosensitivity caused by tetracycline taken for acne. An unfavorable reaction would be one that is noxious, hurtful, not wholesome, or damaging to the tissue. These types of reactions may occur immediately or may take weeks or months to develop, such as the hirsutism, buffalo hump, or gynecomastia seen in long-term steroid use. So again, adverse events are unfavorable, unintended, undesirable, occurs at therapeutic dosages. These include development of pancytopenia from chlorpheniramine versus a side effect, which is an additional effect, desirable or undesirable, not the primary purpose of giving the drug. And an example of this can include photosensitivity caused by tetracycline taken for acne. I'm going to refer you to Table 3.2 in the Edmonds text for looking at adverse drug reactions and their side effects. The incidence of adverse drug reactions has been estimated to at around 28%, accounting for about 3 to 6.7% of all hospital admissions. The World Health Organization adverse reaction terminology, which is a subset of the International Classification of Diseases, classifies adverse drug reactions into 6 types: a dose-related, augmented, non-dose-related, bizarre, dose-related and time-related, chronic, time-related, delayed, withdrawal, end of use, and failure of therapy. Failure. Most adverse drug reactions occur as a result of extension of the desired pharmacological effect of a drug, often due to variability in the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics seen among patients. Drugs such as warfarin and digoxin are at higher risk for causing adverse drug reactions, particularly because of their narrow therapeutic index when toxicity can occur at drug concentrations at or near the upper end of therapeutic range. Elderly and pediatric patients are also highly vulnerable because drug absorption and metabolism are more variable and less predictable in both of these groups. Some research suggests that numbers of adverse drug reactions per patient in both the pediatric age group and the elderly are higher compared with the middle age range, with the highest rates of ADRs occurring in the octogenarians at a rate of 60 adverse drug reactions per 10,000 people. Elderly patients with comorbidity who are taking multiple medications, those who have a history of adverse drug reactions, and those with reduced capacity to eliminate medications are at higher risk. Exposure to toxic chemicals through the lifetime can have a neurologic modulating effect that may last a lifetime. As people age, a decreasing trend in hepatic metabolizing capacity can affect their ability to clear medications and chemicals assimilated from the environment. This trend, along with decreased urinary clearance, may cause prolonged retention of chemicals in the body. Research has demonstrated that the half-life of drugs processed by hepatic P450 enzymes or through renal elimination is 50 to 70% longer in those older than 65 than in other adults. Common liver and kidney disease may further decrease drug and chemical clearance from these organs. The polypharmacy that is common among elderly patients may increase the likelihood of drug interactions in the body and potentiating side effects. The nervous system also undergoes changes with aging, including neural loss, altered neurotransmitter and receptor levels, and decreased adaptability to changes initiated by xenobiotics, making the patients more susceptible to neurologic changes. In women, a few pharmacokinetic differences can contribute to adverse drug reactions. The menstrual cycle and menopausal status can affect the metabolism of some drugs, as can the effects of some supplemental estrogen-progesterone combinations, or estrogen alone. An important consideration in women is the influence of a drug on the effectiveness of oral contraception. Over-the-counter medications, herbal medications, and oral contraceptive pills often are overlooked when one is taking a medical history in patients, and a careful inventory of all medications taken by patients should be performed so harmful drug interactions can be avoided. If a suspected drug adverse reaction occurs, it's important to confirm and document the reaction. The key questions should be answered include, has the observed reaction been previously documented to be due to a drug taken by the patient? Is the time course of the reaction consistent with the times of drug administration? Could this reaction be due to another clinical condition in the patient? Did the reaction improve when the drug was discontinued? If not discontinued, did the reaction resolve? If the dose was reduced but did not discontinue the drug, did the reaction resolve? If an antidote was given, did the patient's condition improve? Did the reaction reoccur when the when or if the drug was administered again, and was the dose appropriate for the patient in terms of age or organ function. All these questions should be asked. Serious adverse drug reactions or events are defined by the FDA as events caused by a drug that results in a patient's death, hospitalization, or disability, or that causes a congenital abnormality or life-threatening event, or requires an intervention to prevent permanent damage. It's been estimated that each year more than 770,000 people in the United States who are hospitalized experience ADRs at a rate that has increased 15% over the past several years, costing major hospitals up to $5.6 million per year. The estimate does not include ADRs that result in admissions, malpractice, and litigation costs, or the costs of injuries to patients. The annual cost of national hospital expenses to treat patients who experience ADRs during the hospitalization are estimated to be between $1.5 billion to $5.6 billion. Although published reports indicate that thousands of deaths occur each year as a result of medical errors, the true number of deaths attributed to ADRs is unknown. Again, more than 770,000 people in the U.S. are hospitalized due to ADRs, and these should be voluntarily reported to the FDA, Medical Products MedWatch reporting program, by calling the number, and that's included in this text, in this slide. Most ADRs occur as a result of extension of the desired pharmacological effect of the drug, often due to variability in the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics seen among patients. Drugs such as warfarin and digoxin are at higher risk of causing ADRs, particularly because of their narrow therapeutic index, when toxicity can occur at drug concentrations at or near the upper end of the therapeutic range. Elderly and pediatric patients are also highly variable because of drug absorption and metabolism, and are more variable and less predictable in both of these groups. Some research suggests that the numbers of ADRs per patient in both pediatric age group and in the elderly are higher compared with the middle age range, with the highest rates of ADRs occurring in octogenarians. Again, there's many causes of elderly and pediatric patients in women, and as well as over-the-counter medications being taken by these patients. Food and drug interactions also occur. Interactions occur as a result of activation of the P450 enzyme system or competition with receptor sites. Some common include monoamine oxidase inhibitors, nicotine, and caffeine. And take a look at Table 3.3 in the Edman text, and this will list the most common. Most adverse drug reactions are non-allergic. They may result from overdosage or if biotransformation or excretion of normal doses is impaired, or if intake of medication is excessive. They might be a side effect reflecting an unavoidable non-therapeutic effect of the drug, a paradoxical effect, or an effect opposite of what is expected may develop. Drug interactions may occur, or an idiosyncratic reaction may result from unusual resistance to large doses or unexpected responses to ordinary or even low doses. alcohol is another product with vast potential for interactions with drugs. In an alert distributed by the National Institute of Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism, it was estimated that alcohol-medication interactions may be a factor in at least 25% of all emergency department admissions. However, this is an old figure and probably much higher. An unknown number of less serious interactions go unrecognized or unrecorded. It's been estimated that approximately 70% of the adult population consumes alcohol at least occasionally, and up to 10% of people may drink daily. And again, this is probably an underestimate. Data from the 210 Behavioral Risk Factor Surveillance System revealed that more than 38 million U.S. adults are binge drinkers, drinking alcohol excessively, an average of 4 times a month. In the journal Vital Signs, the Center for Disease Control and Prevention, researchers reported that binge drinking was most prevalent among adults aged 18 to 34. These figures, together with the facts concerning the substantial numbers of people who take medications, suggest that some concurrent use of alcohol and medications is inevitable. One segment of the population at particular risk for alcohol-drug interactions consists of the elderly, who take 25 to 30% of all prescription medications. Elderly individuals are more likely to experience medication side effects than our younger persons, and these effects tend to be more severe with advancing age. Among persons aged 60 years or older, 10% of these in the community and 40% of those in nursing homes fulfill criteria for alcohol abuse. Seniors who report binge drinking did so much more often on average. Again, geriatric population is at risk. An acute dose of alcohol may inhibit drug metabolism by competing with a drug for the same set of metabolizing enzymes, and chronic alcohol ingestion may activate drug metabolizing enzymes, decreasing the drug's ability and diminishing its effect. Both drugs and alcohol travel through the bloodstream to exert the desired effects on the body. With alcohol, the site of action is the brain. Therefore, intoxication occurs until the alcohol has been finally metabolized and eliminated, primarily by the liver. The extent to which an administered dose of a drug reaches its site of action is described in terms of its availability. Alcohol can influence the effectiveness of a drug by altering its availability. Typical alcohol-drug interactions include an acute dose of alcohol, a single drink or several drinks over several hours, which may inhibit a drug's metabolism by competing with the drug for the same set of metabolizing enzymes. This interaction prolongs and enhances the drug's availability, potentially increasing the patient's risk of experiencing harmful side effects from the drug. In contrast, chronic, long-term alcohol ingestion may activate drug metabolizing enzymes, thus decreasing the drug's availability and diminishing its effect. After these enzymes have been activated, they remain so even in the absence of alcohol, thereby affecting the metabolism of certain drugs for several weeks after cessation of drinking. A recently abstinent chronic drinker may need higher doses of some medications than are required by non-drinkers to achieve therapeutic levels. Enzymes activated by chronic alcohol consumption transform some drugs into toxic chemicals that can damage the liver or other organs. alcohol can magnify the inhibitory effect of sedative and narcotic drugs at their sites of action in the brain. To add to the complexity of these interactions, some drugs affect the metabolism of alcohol, thus altering its potential for intoxication and the adverse effects associated with alcohol consumption. The Institute on Alcohol Abuse and Alcoholism alert is precise in summarizing common drug to alcohol interactions. You can see this in Edmonds on table 3-4. When patients are taking prescription medications, the additional use of over-the-counter products may become a problem as well. Although specific drugs should be evaluated for the potential over-the-counter interactions, it's important to be aware of common interactions. Patients should always read the label of over-the-counter products because common drug interactions are listed in the warning section of those labels. Patients who experience side effect after taking an over-the-counter medication for a common ailment should discontinue the product at once and consult their healthcare provider for guidance. Herbal product interactions also occur with prescription drugs. Estimate of concurrent use of complementary and alternative medication products with allopathic medicine may vary from 39 to as high as 46% of patients, depending on the population. The significance of herb-drug interactions varies, but it's essential to recognize that any interaction has the potential to cause harm. Some prescription drugs that are the greatest concern, such as anticoagulants or antiplatelet medications, are those that have a narrow therapeutic window. Top-selling herbal drugs such as ginkgo, ginseng, and garlic are known to interact with anticoagulants or antiplatelet drugs. Camille, Dong Quai, Don Shen, and ginger also may adversely interact with these drugs. It is of particular concern that most patients who are taking both prescription and herbal medication products do not report this to their healthcare providers. The NIH National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medication has a listing of herbal products and the potential interactions with common medications that may be consumed when the providers do learn that patients are using herbal products. You can look this up on the internet. Again, it's the NIH National Center for Complementary and Alternative Medicine. Although changes in patient health, compliance factors, and over-aggressive therapy may occasionally lead to overdosage, the most frequent cause of drug toxicity is accidental overdosage. Patients who repeat doses because they cannot remember whether they took their medication because of confusion over proper dosages or because the failure to make needed modifications may experience drug toxicity, particularly with those medications with narrow therapeutic margins. Patients at either end of the age spectrum are particularly susceptible to high accumulation of medications because of their relative distribution of muscle, bone, and adipose tissue. With over-the-counter products such as ibuprofen and acetaminophen, the dosage for small infants, children, and adults varies dramatically. The suggested amount may not always seem logical. However, the wrong drug dosage may prove lethal. Additionally, even well-maintained patients may become intolerant of their medications if they become dehydrated. Some of the earliest signs of toxicity may be subtle. For example, the first sign of digoxin toxicity may include feelings of fatigue and heaviness of the legs, malaise, slight confusion, lack of appetite, inability to concentrate, mild weakness, and changes in sleeping patterns are all easy to overlook unless the clinician has some index of suspicion that toxicity may be a factor. Unfortunately, the relatively high number of cases of overdosage or poisoning occur in children inadvertently, when children inadvertently take medication while unsupervised. Little children may open pill containers left at the bedside or in the bathroom cupboards and may confuse the pills with that of candy. Even vitamins and iron may prove lethal to small children. Despite the national campaign to childproof homes, the number of children who die each year as a result of drug overdosage is far too high. It also cannot be ignored that some patients, for a variety of reasons, deliberately overdose on medications. Some of these episodes are true suicide attempts. Others represent actions that occur because of alcoholic confusion or attempts to gain chemical highs that go wrong. The medication overdose treatment advice in the physician's desk reference is not accurate and should not be used. Therefore, an immediate call to the pharmacist at the local or regional poison center will yield superior information for clinicians who seek to respond to possible or confirmed cases of drug overdosage. Other information may be obtained by consulting the pharmaceutical manufacturer of the drug. Every type of drug therapy carries a risk that may be worth taking if the benefits exceeds the predictable morbidity and mortality rates of the therapy itself. This is fairly simple to determine for short-term therapy in which results are quickly seen or the therapy can be terminated if toxicity becomes evident. Risks and benefits are more complicated to calculate for long-term therapy because the results may not be seen until after months or years of treatment. With long-term care, it's more difficult for the clinician to determine whether therapy should be terminated if some toxicities develop because the amount of good that is sacrificed is not always clear, especially for the patient. For example, methotrexate is an agent that is highly toxic to the bone marrow and the liver, but it offers substantial hope in preventing joint dysfunction in patients with rheumatoid arthritis. When methotrexate is properly administered and closely monitored, the risk is slight compared to the potential for joint preservation. However, vitamin D therapy for rheumatoid arthritis is not recommended because the morbidity is far greater than the modest expected benefit. Unsuccessful and even dangerous therapies were given for decades before the medical profession realized that they did more harm than good. Increasingly, information summarized from research studies on the practice of evidence-based medicine will help to define benefit and risk more clearly in the future. Large-scale randomized clinical controlled trials of drugs will continue to provide data about whether drugs should be used or what degree of risk the patient may be facing with their prescription. The risk-benefit ratio expresses the amount of acceptable risk of adverse reaction or treatment failure that a patient may face in taking drug versus the calculation of its potential benefit. It is generally estimated for each drug. The patient and the provider together must determine the degree of risk that will be tolerated. This will probably depend on the severity of the disease for which patient is being treated. A great example of this is chemotherapy for cancer. Patients become very sick when they have chemotherapy, even life-threatening. However, the risk versus benefit of taking the chemotherapy to try to reduce the size of the tumor has to be weighed out. How do we optimize dosage regimens? calculating the therapeutic index. The decision to use pharmacological therapy requires the clinician to determine what degree of drug effect is desirable and achievable. If some effect of the drug can be measured easily, such as blood pressure for antihypertensive medication, this can guide dosages. The medication can be adjusted up or down to achieve the optimal dosage in both a practical and sensible manner. However, often it's not possible to measure drug effects so simply. The clinician will have to establish some decision rules about how often to change dosage and by how much. Alternatively, some drugs have very little dose-related toxicity, and maximum efficacy is usually desired. For these drugs, doses well in excess of the average required will both ensure efficacy and prolong drug action. So looking at therapeutic window, this compares the range of effective drug concentration versus the safety of the drug. In this graph, you'll see that drug A has a much wider therapeutic window than drug B, even though both drugs have the same therapeutic index. Effective dose and lethal doses are seen in these concentrations. Effective dose of 50 and a lethal dose of 50 in A, and the same as in B. The therapeutic index is a measure of drug safety. It's calculated by dividing the toxic or lethal dose of the therapeutic or effective dose by the therapeutic or effective dose. Is the toxic or lethal dose in 50% of the population? And ED50 is the effective or therapeutic dose in 50% of the population. Response of the patient to the drug may be increased by factors that cause higher blood concentrations of a drug or by factors that make the patient more sensitive to a given blood concentration. The therapeutic response is monitored by examining the index of therapeutic effect to determine whether the therapeutic goal has been attained. For example, if the infection has been suppressed. It should be discriminating and should be practical to measure. The index of toxic effect may also be measured. Again, the measurement should be discriminant and should be sensitive to detect toxicity promptly and should be practical to measure. The concept of therapeutic window is not the same as therapeutic index. The therapeutic window describes a range between the lowest therapeutic concentration and the beginning of toxicity. Some drugs have very narrow therapeutic windows, making patient monitoring especially important. Several different strategies may be used to determine how much medication should be used. This includes determining a target level, maintenance dosing, and loading dose, individualizing therapy, and performing therapeutic drug monitoring. Again, the therapeutic index is a measure of drug safety. It's calculated by dividing the toxic or lethal dose by the therapeutic or effective dose, where the LD50 is the toxic or lethal dose in 50% of the population, and the ED50 is the effective or therapeutic dose in 50% of the population. In target level dosing, a desired or target steady state concentration of the drug usually in plasma, is identified and a dosage is computed that is expected to achieve this value. Drug concentrations are subsequently measured and the dosage is adjusted if necessary to approximate the target more closely. The type of dosing is advisable when the effects of the drug are difficult to measure or if the drug is given for prophylaxis. Target level dosing is also used when toxicity and lack of efficacy are potential problems or when the therapeutic window is very narrow. All of these situations require careful titration of dosages. When target level dosing is used, the therapeutic objective must relate to an established blood serum therapeutic range, such as that seen with theophylline or digoxin levels. The lower limit of the therapeutic range appears to be approximately equal to the drug concentration that produces about half of the greatest possible therapeutic effect. The upper limit of the therapeutic range is fixed by toxicity, not by efficacy. Usually the upper limit of the therapeutic range is such that no more than 5 to 10% of patients will experience a toxic effect. These figures are highly variable, however, the target usually is chosen as the center of this therapeutic range. A maintenance dose, most drugs are administered as continuous infusions or as a series of doses designed to maintain steady state concentration of the drug in plasma and to keep it within a given therapeutic range. To achieve maintenance dose, the rate of the drug administered is adjusted such that the rate of input equals the rate of loss. If a clinician knows the clearance and availability of the drug in a particular patient, the appropriate dose and dosing interval may be calculated to achieve the desired concentration of the drug in plasma. The loading dose needs to be considered if the target concentration of a dose must be met rapidly. A loading dose or a dose or a series of doses is given at the onset of therapy. This may be desirable if the time required to attain steady state through administration of the drug at a constant rate, 4 to 5 elimination half-life, is long relative to demands of the concentration for which the patient is being treated. This is commonly seen with antiarrhythmic drugs when the effect of the drug is required immediately. Because loading doses tend to be large and often given parenterally and rapidly, they can be particularly dangerous if toxic effects occur as a result of actions of the drug. Common drug that we give a loading dose is digoxin. An overly sensitive individual may be exposed abruptly to toxic concentration of the drug. If the drug involved has a long half-life, it may take a long time for concentration to fail if the level achieved is excessive. Individualizing dose information about the patient helps in tailoring the dosage. Calculation of glomerular filtration rate and creatinine clearance may be required to determine dosage in individuals with kidney disease. Adjustment of dosage to compensate for liver damage may be necessary. Comorbidity and the concurrent use of other medications, food, or alcohol may also require dosage modifications to achieve the desired level in the patient. Countless patients have been found to try to save money by splitting tablets. The resulting tablets may vary greatly from the intended dose. This practice is so common that in 2011, the FDA asked drug makers of branded and generic products to score tablets that patients commonly divide so that there is more accurate dosage and that the dosage amount meant to be achieved after splitting the tablet would not be below the minimum therapeutic dose indicated on approved labeling. They also maintain that modified release tablets in which control of the drug release can be compromised by splitting should not be scored. Therapeutic drug monitoring involves measuring serum drug levels in patients receiving drugs with narrow therapeutic windows to maximize efficiency and minimize toxicity. Some of the most common administered drugs that may be closely monitored through serum blood levels include theophylline, phenytoin, carbamazepine, digoxin, and aminoglucoside antibiotics. In monitoring serum levels, serum drug levels, it's important to consider the time of sampling of the drug concentration. If intermittent dosing is used, the concentration of drug measured in a sample taken at virtually any time during the dosage interval will provide information about drug toxicity and may be used to confirm other clinical findings that suggest toxicity. However, serum drug levels used to measure drug concentration for the purpose of adjusting dosage regimen must be taken at specified times to reflect accurate levels. Drug levels vary dramatically through the dosing cycle because the blood level rises and falls throughout the day as in a trough. A blood sample is taken shortly after the drug is administered. If a blood sample is taken shortly after the drug is administered, the level may be uninformative or even misleading. Levels may be very high but not reflective of toxicity. Conversely, levels may be low because distribution is delayed relative to change in plasma concentration. When the goal of measurement is adjustment of dosage, the sample should be taken well after the previous dose is given. As a rule of thumb, one should test just before the next planned dose when the concentration is at its minimum level. However, this does not provide relevant information about drugs that are nearly completely eliminated between doses. For individuals with renal failure or in whom concerns about drug accumulation are high, determination of both maximum and minimum concentrations are recommended. Before taking serum sample, it's important to consider whether the patient has reached steady state concentrations. Steady state usually is achieved after 4 to 5 half-lives have passed. If a sample is obtained too soon after dosage is started, it will not accurately reflect clearance. Yet, for toxic drugs, if one waits until the drug is at steady state, the level may already be within a toxic range. The protocol in Goodman and Gilman's suggests that when it is important to maintain careful control of concentrations, one may take the first sample after 2 half-lives as calculated and expected for the patient, assuming that no loading dose has been given. If the concentration already exceeds 90% of the eventual expected mean steady state concentration, the dosage rate should be halved. Another sample obtained in another 2 half-lives and the dosage halved again if the sample exceeds the target. If the first concentration is not too high, one proceeds with the initial rate of dosage. Even if the concentration is lower than expected, one usually can wait until steady state is achieved in another 2 half-lives and then can proceed to adjust dosage. In Edmonds, Table 3.9 shows the best time to draw blood samples for several different medications. And again, a lot of medications, there are charts in which you can look up when it's the best time to draw blood levels. Practical application of drug prescribing. When underlying scientific principles inherent to pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics are applied, some very practical suggestions can be made for rational drug therapy. Always try non-pharmacological therapy first. Continue it even after medication has been started. Use a drug only when clearly indicated for a specific purpose. It may be difficult for a provider to resist prescribing medication for every symptom that annoys the patient, particularly when the patient is demanding resolution or relief. Well-directed advice and sound instructions often substitute for a medication. Use only one drug whenever possible. Many patients with chronic disease who take numerous medications may need to have the drug stopped and reevaluated. Elderly patients in particular may have been on these drugs almost forever and nobody has ever thought to stop them. They may have had an acute illness that required additional medications at higher dosages that are no longer required. Some patients may become very attached to particular drugs and do not want to stop them. Use the lowest effective dose. If dosage is titrated up to a higher level and no additional benefit is seen, titrate it down to the previous dose. This saves money and decreases the risk of adverse effects. Drug reactions are often dose-related and may be prompted by the philosophy that if a little bit is good an added amount will do no harm and may ensure success. Start low and go slow. Usually change doses by no more than 50% and no more than often than every 3 to 4 half-lives. This usually means no change for 1 to 2 weeks after a dose is started. Simplify the regimen whenever possible. Give the fewest doses and at the most convenient hours of the day to improve compliance. If possible, use the side effect profile of one drug to treat other symptoms. For example, if the patient has depression and insomnia, use trazodone, which may be sedating, instead of Zoloft or Prozac, which are most commonly associated with insomnia. If a patient wants to quit smoking and is depressed, you may want to try Wellbutrin, which is effective against depression and also helps with smoking cessation. Monitor closely for therapeutic effects. Although drug levels may be evaluated as appropriate, trust your observation of the patient's clinical response more than the blood level. For example, the therapeutic level of phenytoin is usually between 10 and 20 micrograms per mil. However, elderly patients often do best on a drug level of 8 micrograms per mil. Drugs that are given over prolonged periods are more apt to produce adverse reactions, thus the dosage must be carefully monitored and reduced at the first sign of difficulty. Keep good patient records. History of allergy, recent hepatitis, renal insufficiency, smoking, alcoholism, or other comorbidity helps to alert the healthcare provider that the patient may be at greater risk for developing adverse reactions or drug-to-drug interactions. Be particularly careful with some drugs that are highly associated with adverse effects. Insulin, steroids, and many drugs used in chemotherapy and AIDS treatment are good examples. Description of these drugs mandates that the healthcare provider offer extensive education to the patient and the family if the drugs are to be used safely. Always keep drug interactions and adverse effects in mind when evaluating the patient. They are the rule rather than the exception. When using drugs with a great potential for adverse reactions, careful monitoring may prevent serious problems. Pancytopenia need not occur if leukopenia is detected early. Deafness will not result if signs of eighth nerve impairment are properly investigated. It is not just luck that allows the healthcare provider to help the patient avoid problems with drug therapy. It is knowledge. Finally, stay up to date. Many journals hold articles for 6 to 12 months before publication. Most textbooks are in production for longer than a year after they are submitted for publication. Thus, these sources of information may be outdated before they're even printed. New research findings should constantly be consulted and evaluated. Valid findings should be incorporated into practice. In this age of electronic information dissemination, the standards of practice may be expected to shift to incorporate more new knowledge than was ever available before. Thus, it's imperative for clinicians to find ways to update their knowledge on a regular basis.